So the last topic that we're going to cover today are soft bodies. Actually, let's go into presentation mode. Soft bodies. Flex is capable of computing soft body deformation, and actually we don't need any more constraints or much deeper knowledge than what we already have. So basically, a soft body also consists of a group of particles. And we also define inside this set of particles shape matching constraints, like we just did with the rigid bodies. We just make sure that they overlap somehow and that the stiffness is not like super stiff. And by doing that, basically, you would have two kind of locked rigid bodies, and as soon as one moves, the other one moves as well, and so on. And then it resolves for kind of finding an equilibrium for all the forces in this thing. In addition to doing that, we can also add springs. So basically, a soft body consists of nothing but a group of particles, that is where clusters of particles are bound together through shape matching constraints. And there are also additional springs in there. So that's more or less the only thing that soft bodies do. We of course have to find a good way in Grasshopper to bring that information to the solver so that it computes all of these things properly. So the shape matching constraints, of course, must overlap, otherwise your soft body would disintegrate. And like as you can see here, these soft bodies kind of all overlap. So I would have kind of a coupling between this cluster and this cluster through these three overlapping particles. And if this one moves down, the other one will move down, and then this one that is coupled will move down, and so on and so on. That is not how actual, like physically, soft body deformation would work. It's more like a visualization of soft bodies, and we shouldn't rely on that being accurate. Also, when you have like a steel beam and you want to see how it deforms, you shouldn't like consider FlexHopper to give you a precise representation of the deformation. You can tune it and tweak the parameters in a way that it looks and resembles something like that, but it's not at all physically accurate. So there are a few things that influence how the soft bodies are simulated. A different thing to keep in mind is that the solver again performs this a number of iterations per step, and the more iterations you have, num iteration is the name of the parameter, the more often the constraints get resolved in each time step. So if you have that 200, then in each frame, these constraints will be stepwise resolved 100 times. So it's not like solving everything once and putting it out onto the display, but it's resolving it step by step and trying to kind of minimize the error between conflicting constraints. So the higher your number of iteration, the slower your simulation gets, but the more reliable it is. And obviously, the lower it is, the faster, but then also a little bit unreliable. Shape matching constraints and springs can have individual stiffnesses, so that's a those are parameters that you can tweak yourself however you want, whatever you want your simulation to show. The size of the clusters, because of this overlapping paradigm, the size of the clusters and the overlap heavily influences the soft body behavior. So if you have very small clusters and they just overlap at a few particles, then the whole thing might be super wobbly and maybe even like perform or look like some sort of goo. If you have just three shape matching constraints with very large overlap, then the whole thing might look like a stiff, rigid body. So, and it's really up to you how you want to tune the parameters. We're going to go through how to tune these parameters and then how it will look differently. Obviously, I mean, also, you have to make sure that there is an overlap between all particles. If you have three particles, then this one will just move as it wasn't, like it's not influenced by any constraint. If you have no overlap, for example, like these ones, they will just behave like a normal shape matching constraint, what we did before, and they're not influenced by any other bodies. So that will more be like a granulate or some, rigid bodies. Exactly. That's what I just said. Disconnected clusters without overlap will cause disintegration of the soft body. And with that, we can already jump to the next soft shell. Just keep in mind that soft body deformation is nothing but overlapping rigid bodies, so to say, that are not very rigid. and the overlap, the degree of overlap and the size of these clusters defines how stiff our rigid body, our soft body is. So please open that file, soft shell. We can actually also, if you want, we can also start with the bunny. Do you want shells or bunnies first? We'll do both. Okay, then let's do the bunny.
How about bunny falling on the shell?
Sorry?
Bunny falling on the shell.
That could be a good like final project that we set up together and then... Okay, then let's start with the bunny.
Soft bunny.
Soft bunny, exactly. I think so. Should be soft bunny. I don't even know how that looks like at the moment. Okay, you might see something like that. I will just reset everything. I will also... Does it look the same for you, that file? I don't know if I saved it differently.
You have a bunch of bunnies.
You have a bunch of bunnies. If you have a bunch of bunnies, just hit that toggle. That should switch between one bunny or multiple bunnies. So set it to false and you should have one. I will also turn all preview off because we just start with the initial mesh and that's it. So preview selected off for everything. But I think this one should be on exactly. So this mesh here is our original mesh. The only thing I do here is to move that up a little bit so it can fall from higher. And here I just filter or I switch if I want to have one or multiple. If you switch that, then it's multiple. Just because they're here, again, oriented randomly. But I just want to talk about this one now, or we just show this one. So that's the Stanford bunny. It's like a classic kind of example geometry that is used for all kinds of stuff to test all kinds of algorithms. So obviously we also have to use that bunny. You can also see in the NVIDIA, some demo videos, they also play with that bunny. It's a common thing. Okay, the next thing, or what is actually going on here in the simulation, is we have again the flex engine, we have the flex scene and the collision geometry. And the scene this time only uses the soft input. And this soft input comes from the soft component. You can find that up here if you want to play with it, but you don't have to do it now. It's like this fluffy teddy bear. And that's a soft component. So this soft component accepts a mesh as an input, initial velocity. If you want your thing to move somewhere, you can give it an initial velocity, the mass per particle, and these params and the group index. If I turn that on, you can see that it looks something like this. So basically, what we did before with the defining a shape for a rigid body by just grouping a group of particles into one shape matching constraint, this component helps you doing that, or it does it basically for you, and it takes an input mesh and turns it into a first into a set of particles, and second it groups these particles. So let me just show you what happens if I change these parameters. So these parameters are really crucial. Wait, how do I change them now? Cluster spacing, yes. I just want... Okay, no. Let's do it differently. Turn that off and only show the particle output. Okay. So as you can see, the component fills this bunny with particles. And this is mostly based on one of the parameters in here. When you go to params, also be careful, this might get slow if you change the parameters too much. But you can see the first one, input zero, is particle spacing, and that basically defines how far apart these particles are from each other. So it can give you like a sort of idea how fine-grained this simulation is. If I set it to 0.5 now, I should see more particles being generated. So now I just basically fill that mesh with a cloud of particles. And from there, I want to decide I want to turn that into compartments, into clusters of overlapping shapes. In order to do that, I have a few more parameters that are important. You can see parameter number 3 is cluster spacing and cluster radius. So when we go back to this example, say to this one, we could say that the cluster radius or the cluster spacing is how far clusters are apart from each other, like the distance between the centers of each cluster, and cluster radius is the size of it. So if you want the clusters to overlap, which we always want, you want the spacing to be smaller than the radius. So that basically defines how large your clusters will be. Oops, sorry, wrong rhino. So now here I have as my params, 3 cluster spacing is 1.5 and cluster radius is 2. I think I will set it a little bit lower now, a little bit higher, because I don't want too many clusters for now. So I'm gonna set it to 3 and say 5.
So change 1.5 at 2 to 3 and 5.
You don't have to do that. I'm just showing you now. Maybe later we can tweak it. You can also see that it's like on this machine it takes 2.3 seconds, and that's like a super fast machine. So if you're not careful, this might like really freeze your system for a while. to get an initial idea of how your clusters now look like, we can take the box output of the soft body and just put it into the soft thing. And those boxes are basically the bounding boxes of your clusters. Maybe let me reduce that a little, let me increase that a little bit more to 6 and 10. I hope you can see it better then. I think my radius is too big, sorry. Turn the radius to 8. So if we now, maybe it's even better to visualize it differently. So I remove this particle component. I just take the first item. I just want to show you the first box or one of these boxes. You don't have to do that now. One smaller 10, let's say. So here from this bunny, that would be one cluster. And then you also have the SPI output. That's for springs. And you have the SMI. That's for shape matching constraints, so for your points. So as you can see, we have a tree with 10 branches. That means we have 10, we defined 10 clusters, 10 shape matching constraints, and they have this and that number of particles in there. So I'm just, as I retrieve the item number 0, the box number 0 from my particle tree here, I will now retrieve tree branch number 0. I think that is that, if I'm not mistaken. I hope. Tree and this. Nope. Ah, yeah, sorry. Those are indices, so those are just numbers. Now I also have to get the items from the flattened particle list. So now you can see that is one cluster that this little helper component defined for me. The second one would be this, this, and so on. So those are these overlapping constraints, right?
Can you see the definition? It's interesting that we can follow it up.
What do you mean, definition of what?
This, the thing that we just did.
Okay, this one, yes. So basically, from this B output box, I just retrieve one item that is defined by a slider. And then basically the particle output gives me a flattened list of all particles. And in the SMI output, it basically gives me the indices relative to the particles for each cluster as a tree. So as there are 10 clusters defined, if I retrieve the same tree branch from here as I retrieve the item from the box, it would give me the indices for the respective particles. And as those are only indices, they refer to items in the list of particles. So I have to use the item component like that. Oh, that's, I think that's only in Flexhopper 1.1. I think you don't have that. Yeah, sorry. So in this kind of visualization feature is only there in Flexhopper 1.1. If you use Flexhopper 1.01, the slightly older version, I think you don't have all of these outputs. You just get the soft body. The content of the soft body is the same. That's what you pass on to the, that's what you pass on to the scene. All of this stuff is just for your information, so it makes it easier for you to set up your scene and your soft bodies. But it's, yeah. Okay. I will now play with these parameters a little bit, because I think the clusters are really big and it might be a pretty slow computation. So first of all, I would increase the first parameter. The first one is particle spacing, so the distance between neighboring particles. If I increase that, I will get less particles, obviously, because it will fill up this mesh. So I will set it to, say, 1.5. And that's way less particles. The first one to, for example, 1.5. So what other parameters do we have there? We will leave input 1 and 2 out for now. We have cluster spacing and cluster radius. Let's play with that a little bit too. So this is my box, and this is my, those are my respective particles inside of that box or inside of the cluster. When I move around now, you can see the clusters are still pretty big. The overlap is also kind of large, which is good because we don't want our software to disintegrate or anything, but I will still play with it. I always forget parameters. So the number 3 is cluster spacing and number 4 is cluster radius. So let's say I want more clusters and they should have a slightly smaller overlap. So I will set the cluster, the distance between cluster centers to maybe 3 times the size of the distance between particles. So 4.5, and the cluster radius keep at the same. As you can see now, when I move around here, I hardly have any overlap. Yeah. Because both my cluster distance, cluster spacing and cluster radius are the same. So I want some more overlap. I'm just going to set this value to 6 again. So now the clusters get larger. Not bad. Okay. Is that okay so far? As I said before in the presentation file, that there are also springs included, and the component also takes care of generating springs for you. So as we have the cluster spacing, we also have a link radius and link stiffness, number 6 and 7, and those relate to the spring radius and spring stiffness. So if I, from each particle, I have a certain radius, and it will look up every particle in that distance around it and form a spring to it. So you can, the easy display would just be to tell it to show you what spring line output gives you. So SL is the spring line. I plug that into a curve, and those are all the springs that were created. So I have all my points here. Those are all particles. Maybe let me turn off the bunny and turn off this box. So those are all my bunny particles, and those are all internally created springs. If I don't want any springs, I just set it to 0. But I want a few more springs now, so I'm going to set the spring radius number 6 to something higher, say 2. You will see that the number of springs increases. If I set it to 3, it's even more. If I set it to 10, I basically have springs between all particles. It's maybe a little bit too much. That is the SL outputs. That's the spring curve outputs. So the SPI output is something similar to the SMI outputs. SMI is the particle indices for each cluster, and SPI are spring indices for each spring. So that's just there for your information. You don't need it now because we have this SL output, but if you wanted to, you could now also go in and have a look at the indices for each spring. So the first spring is between particle 0 and 22, second is between 0 and 25, 0, 26, 0, 4, and so on and so on and so on. So there's a tree branch for each spring. We have 3,600 springs. So therefore, we have 3,650 tree branches. Okay. Is that clear so far, what that does? Okay. If I turn on box preview for all of them, like if I turn on all the boxes, I can see that it looks like this. And that looks pretty much okay. We can just try what happens. Also, in the parameters, there is one thing that I didn't change, the value number 7. What, crashed?
No.
No, okay. A value number 7 is link stiffness. That's set to 0 here, but we want the springs to be a little bit stiffer, so I set it to 0.4. And then there's also cluster stiffness. That's the 5th value. That is at 0.1 now. So I'm going to set that a little higher too, to 0.6 maybe. You can also define it differently. It's not so. Okay. So, again, for your information, if you want to know more about what you actually created, you can plug... Oh, no, sorry, there's no information about soft bodies. That should be added soon. Usually there should be an info here now. But okay. So soft bodies plugs into the softs in the scene. Then I just defined a collider geometry. That's, again, the floor plane. And that's already all I need for this simulation. Maybe we can do that again together. Or maybe we don't need to do it together. But So soft bodies plugs into scene, scene plugs into Flex Engine. And then in order to get that information from the solver, I will use get soft bodies from decomposition. Get soft bodies. I connect Flex and the original soft body information, and I will get that. And now I can run the simulation and see what happens. So that's a pretty stiff soft bunny. We should decrease the stiffness maybe. Just turn it off. And decrease spring stiffness to 0.01 and cluster stiffness to 0.2.
Can you see the number?
Yes. The exact numbers don't matter so much. You should just have some sensible preview here that you don't have like 10,000 boxes and a million particles or something. But let's just
go around a bit. If you have something that, oh, yours is really soft, right? Can you run it again? Because you have relatively small overlap, so really like it's really soft, almost disintegrates. If you increase, for example, cluster radius, you should get like a stiffer. Do you have something that moves here? Yeah, a little bit, right? Yours? did you get anything to work? Because you don't have the proper components. Say get all the articles and just retrieve everything from the simulation. Because you have the multiple money, so I don't want that. You can also connect the get all springs and you will see all springs. But this cluster preview doesn't work in the version. Mm-hmm. So it should be get all springs.
okay, I can just say it. So in FlexHopper 1.0, the previous version, we just had that one of the students here had the same problem. Like here, you will only have one output from this component, and that says particles. That's wrong, it should say soft bodies, and these soft bodies go into the soft body thing. So if you have FlexHopper 1.0, then connect the only particle output to softs here. And then you don't have this get soft body components, but you can say get all particles to get everything from the scene, and you can say get all springs. Get all springs. So then you should be able to see this with FlexHopper 1.0. Unfortunately, this cluster preview doesn't work in the previous version that was just added. Okay, that's actually pretty much it for this thing. I prepared another set of parameters here. Let's see what they do.
Yeah,
that's like much more clusters with a different kind of overlap. To reset the scene in order for the preview to work properly. In the soft body output, you also have these same outputs again. So you have your particles, velocities, you have the, I think springs, spring lines, exactly. The boxes, the containing boxes. And what's that? Ah, meshes, that comes later. I will just add a nicer preview.
Is there a transformational matrix that
we
can
play
to?
Not sure. Wait a second. Because I think... No, not yet, sorry. So that, yeah, the get rigid transformation that we did before for the rigid bodies, right? That doesn't exist for soft bodies. I can add that in the previous release, next release. I actually wanted to do that, but somehow didn't do it yet. Also, color swatch.
Each box is a cluster, right? And what is the overlapping amount there? Just one face?
No, it's like...
One point level there, deep?
You define that yourself.
Yeah, okay, but I'm just curious what your particular setup there, one level deep?
You would have to look that up in the... Let's see if I... here. Preview. Disable that. Preview off. So those are individual clusters. Like
okay.
it doesn't count what the kind of overlap is or the number of overlapping particles, but
yeah,
that's
I see. So it's okay.
What they look like.
These are random points, they're not even voxel points, right?
Random voxel. I see, yeah. I mean they're not
they are voxel
generated
points.
More or less randomly. Okay. So I will just add a nicer preview. I think this preview only works after starting the simulation. This looks a little nicer now, and I can also preview the spring lines in a different color. Why don't I just copy that? Maybe I'll turn those red. So those are now exactly, I mean, those are of course now the same spring lines as we defined up here. They also have the same structure. I think. Oh no, they're a list. Boxes are a list, springs are also a list. Okay, they're not in that, but okay. Just rerunning, and that's how our bunny would deform in that way. Now we can, of course, also add more constraints to the scene. So if I want an anchor, then I will add that to the scene constraints by saying panel number 0, just particle number 0 should be a spring. Ah, sorry, I'm an idiot. It doesn't take a number, it takes a constraint. So from up here, the anchor constraint, I will add the index 0 and add the constraint to the scene. And now we should hopefully see that the bunny doesn't fall, but so we have a lot of particles, but like this one particle being stuck to the thing doesn't like make the whole thing hang because the springs are not strong enough and the clusters are not strong enough. If we increase the spring stiffness and the cluster stiffness, then that should look a little bit better. So I'll say 0.1 for springs. Okay, so the springs are not strong enough. Have to try 0.8 and also cluster stiffness a little bit higher. You could even start like having multiple springs in there. Sorry, multiple anchors in there. Wobble, wobble.
Can you turn off the white box just to see? See the paragon? Yeah. Oh, are they mesh?
No.
It's just point right, but why? What are those lightning? Ah, they are springs.
Those are springs, exactly.
Wait, do we do spring because it's shape matching?
Yeah, you can add springs as well. You can also have no springs and only shape matching constraints. So
if you want to do just kind of convincing looking motion, you just need the shape matching. You can do away with the spring or something.
So if I say link radius, I think if I set it to 0, or if I just set this the link stiffness to 0, wait, that's the wrong, I changed the wrong parameters, why didn't you tell me? I changed the parameters here, but those are connected, and then I wondered why the simulation didn't change. Okay, let's retry. A little better now. So basically all these constraints that we have up here, everything with a little c, can be applied to those particles now too. The only problem being that when we use this kind of mode for to generate soft bodies, where it kind of fills the volume of the initial mesh, is that it does not keep track of the original mesh. So what I cannot do now, unfortunately, I preview that, like I could not maintain this mesh shape, at least not in that version. Maybe it could be added later too. But if the whole thing deforms, I only get the deformation of all the boxes and the springs, but I don't get the original mesh information anywhere here. At least not in this mode. If you look here, the M output mesh is empty. If you want to see that, we have to work a little bit differently. I would suggest that we now switch to the next file, because there I can explain that a little better. Is there anything else going on here? No. The next file would be softshell. So, 04 softshell. Okay, for you this might look differently, I guess. Does it look something like this when you reset? Because I think I might have saved it differently on my machine.
I have one
Hmm? Ah, yes, that's okay. Yeah, or just reset, see what's what here? Yeah. Ah, you did reset, okay. Yeah, it just moves very lightly because the parameters are tuned to be really tight. But as long as it does move,
yeah,
it moves. Yeah, this also moves just very lightly. You should also move, I guess.
Can you reset it?
Yes. Yeah, then that component is
We need to frozen an option.
We had a crash again. That's why, when did it crash? Did you try to generate a soft body?
But what are we out of range of the particle?
That was exactly the reason I added it in the next version, because if you don't see how the clusters look like, then you just run the crash.
Ben, where do we change the gravity?
In the parameters, from values, and the very first one is gravity. By default, it's the normal gravity of minus first one that accepts a vector.
And the weight of the particle, where do we change it?
Hmm?
The mass of the particle?
It needs a vector instead of a number. In the soft body generation thing, wait, does it?
Oh, you can put a minus on the line. The default is map on 8, right?
Yeah.
So max is 0 and min is 10.
A mesh join just puts two meshes together. It just basically adds the list of vertices and and shifts like the faces. And weld removes duplicate vertices. If you have like a disjoint mesh, where it cleans it exactly. It cleans it. And join just puts it together into one mesh structure, but it's not actually clean.
Not necessarily clean. Sometimes you really want to keep those vertex disjoint.
Yeah.
If you have two triangles, if you join them, they will become acquired. But sometimes you want to keep them as two separate triangles. It's just that these two vertex are the same, you don't want to weld them. So it's not like cleaning, you know. Be careful. You try to simply put them together as one rhino object, but it doesn't change the topology or whatever, but where will you change the topology? Vertices are share the same position or close together, but it might have unwanted consequences.
Okay, so I assume you all opened that file. So the problem with the bunny was that we couldn't keep track of the original mesh, right? It would fill the volume, but kind of remove the original mesh. If you have a shell or open mesh, that might be not so useful. So there's also a different mode where you can just, as it tells you in the description of the parameters input, down below here, if you want the particles to precisely resemble the original mesh, that's like called bijective mapping, do not supply the first three values of the components. That's what I did. So instead of, like in the bunnies, I'm just going quickly back, you don't have to do that. Here I supply these 8 values, where the first three define the particle spacing and volume sampling and surface sampling. you can also leave them out, and then the soft body will try to maintain, or basically, turn that on again, sorry. Why do I have to turn all of this on? Just turn that off. So now what will happen is that you have your original mesh, that's the input. I leave the first three values out and let that little helper component and figure out that each mesh vertex should be a particle itself, and then I just apply the cluster spacing, so I can still do that. You see that these points are now, it doesn't fill any volume whatsoever, it just sets the vertices as particles directly. But the other parameters are still valid. I still have to define my my cluster radius and cluster stiffness. So those are, I think, 25. Let me check. And just add. I would just do the same that we did before. So in order to get the cluster points, I will add a slider from 0 to say 20. I retrieve the box item from this B output. So this is the first cluster, and so on and so on. And I also now, when I have 7 here, I also want to retrieve the 7th tree branch of the shape matching indices. So tree branch as the commands. You will have to simplify this input here because the tree has an unnecessary path level to it. So just right-click simplify. And then I use these indices to retrieve the items of the actual points. Turn this off. And now we can see that this is now one cluster, this is one cluster, and so on and so on. Okay, but as opposed as to before, it doesn't generate any new particles, it uses your mesh faces. The advantage of that is when the number of your mesh faces and the number of particles are the same, or if they match, then you can just also reuse that actual mesh topology information to redraw your mesh. So when you're in that mode where you leave the first three values out from the params, you can also redraw the mesh, and that should have an actual output now. So this is my get softbody component again. You know what, why don't we, should we set it up together again, that file from scratch, so you learn the different steps, or is that like enough for you, enough information for you? Okay. When you run the simulation, because it's pretty stiff, like we have a rather high overlap, a rather high stiffness, and also as opposed to before, we have a lot of anchors, because here with these indices, I also defined anchors, like here. Like all of those are anchors. That's just the anchor input, and basically get every particle that is below this point and turn it into an anchor. If I increase that, decrease that, then the anchors get more. So I have a lot of anchors, it's right quite stiff, so that's why it doesn't deform that much. If you change the values here, for example the stiffness, then that should act differently.
Is there any force that tries to
gravity? Yeah, of course. Your scene, when you create a scene, there's always a default value for gravity.
Yeah.
So even if you don't declare anything, gravity still exists. That's why they move down.
Exactly. Sorry, I thought you meant why it moves so little only. I didn't. Yeah.
So you were asking like why it moves at all, right?
No, why it moves slightly, because it moves.
So I mean that you, the question is that why it moves at all. You didn't expect it to move, like your question, like it shouldn't move.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because of gravity, your answer is because of gravity.
Deforms under gravity, exactly.
So because you don't have the friction to the earth, then it moves just like this.
It doesn't have to do with the friction so much, just that it moves down and then, but it's like an elastic body, so it moves up again, so it moves down again. Exactly, we don't have friction, as I just said. We also didn't define damping. You can also increase the damping value in your parameters and then it will just come to a rest quicker. Otherwise, if there's no friction, no damping, it will just move elastically indefinitely.
Can you do the parameters, the show parameters section just
these ones?
Yeah.
I think I added nothing, but yeah, I added nothing.
You added some wind.
I added wind exactly because I now wanted us together to add wind to the scene. So if you want, you can already set the parameters for wind. Let it be a vector here for wind, something that is not zero, and lift and drag should also be not zero. Yeah, because we didn't add the constraints yet. So basically, that's by default. So if you want to add, let me just remove a bunch of stuff. So we have our anchors defined, right? You probably don't have that defined yet. And these. So the wind, as I said, or as we had before, the wind is based on the triangle constraint. So you retrieve a triangle constraint input and just turn every mesh phase of the initial mesh into a triangle. We can do that again together. So I take the initial mesh, I deconstruct it. Deconstruct mesh. Then I deconstruct the mesh faces, all of them. This is a list of mesh faces. I basically need to turn, I basically need a list or a tree where each tree branch are the indices of one mesh face. So that's what I'm doing now with the merge commands. I'm just merging the face indices ABC, and I have to graph them. graph, graph, graph. And that gives me a nice clean tree. For each mesh face, one list of three indices. Exactly, constraints, but don't like hold shift to have both anchors and triangles. Exactly. You could also add more springs now if you want to the scene, or more shape matching constraints, but we actually want this component to take care of that for us. And now there should, the shell should move under wind loads. Simulation is still running. If I now set some wind, see that it deforms, kind of acts under the wind load.